light, will you?
In our example with the coin, we simply know that we just derived here that P is 1/3, or was it 2/3? What we, no, 2/3. So this is the head. Probability of the head is 2/3, and probability of tail is 1/3. So this is a discrete distribution with just two basic outcomes, right? So in general, if a random variable has n discrete values, then whichever probability on these values makes the outcome maximally likely, that's it. But what do we do when the when random variable is continuously distributed, when it's not discrete random variable? Then it turns out that you take, so max likelihood is the value for which probability density, probability density is maximal. And you can see if you kind of approximate this continuous random variable by kind of discretizing domain and integrating over each little piece, that these two are in perfect agreement. So what is the probability of the outcome that we got, assuming that the errors are normal? So first of all, what is the normal distribution? Or other name is Gaussian. Distribution with the mean mu and standard deviation sigma.
Yes. The second max likelihood for continuous random variable.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. 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 So this is this is a maximum likelihood for continuous random variables. So Gaussian distribution with mean mu looks like this. This is mu, and here somewhere where, if I remember it correctly, where this drops either on, where is the inflection point? We can compute it, but width in some sense is the standard deviation. What is the formula for the density? Well, f of x is 1 over square root 2 pi sigma squared, which is the variance, right? E to the minus x minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared. So probability to hit this, the probability density, right? Because any particular number for continuous random variables has probability zero, right? You know, if you pick randomly, if you throw a dart on the interval 0, 1, then probability of any particular real number is zero. But probability over a certain interval is, of course, then size of this interval compared to the whole interval, right? So this is the probability density. Now we are assuming that the measurements are, errors are uncorrelated. So okay, there is a very nice refresher of probability theory on the website in this zero-week material, and I would urge you to read it to refresh basics about probability and very little of statistics. So if random variables are independent, then probability then joint probability density is just product of individual densities, right? So if we made n many measurements probability, so if we measured x1, x2, up to xn, then probability density at that vector, joint probability density of at the point x1 up to xn, is simply the product of individual densities. And we assume that because we are doing the measurement with the very same instrument, all of these probability of all of these outcomes have the same mean and the same variance. So we have probability is just the product will be 1 over 2 pi sigma squared to the power n over 2, right? Times e to the minus, and then here we will have sum of xi minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared. So for these outcomes of the measurement, this is the probability density, the value at this random vector x1 up to xn. This is the joint probability density. So we want to estimate mu and we want to estimate sigma. So let's estimate mu and sigma using max likelihood. What would that be? Well, we have to maximize one of these,
down the chair,
well, I don't want to break my neck. So let's simply compute, in order to find maximum likelihood estimation, we have to differentiate with respect to mu and sigma and set the partial derivatives to zero. So df over d mu is equal to what? So this is all, shoot, there is no pi over there because I put it together. So, okay, look, who wants to do some exercise? I'm really worried I'll fall off, and I know that you would enjoy it, but who is skinny? And come on, I need someone to climb this, and thank you. Just make sure you don't break your neck. Just slow it down. Yeah. Just
he did
perfect.
It.
Thank you.
Good.
Okay, so let me just do a little correction. I took in the product because here it is, and then when I multiply e to this, the exponent simply sum. So this is the. Okay, so let's see what df. Let's see what df over d mu is. This is constant, so it will be just 1 over 2 pi sigma squared to the power n over 2 times. The derivative of e to something is what? Well, that's e to the very same thing. Xi minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared times the derivative of this, which is minus, and then the derivative of this is sum of Xi minus mu times minus 1 because mu is negative and divided by 2 sigma squared. And this has to be equal to 0. Right? So, I am missing something. What am I missing? No, I'm not missing anything. So, what can I, you see, this is not 0. This is not 0, and e to the something is also not 0. So the conclusion is the df over d mu is 0 if and only if sum of xi minus mu I goes from 1 to n is equal to 0. What is this? This is equivalent to sum I equals 1 to n of xi minus sum I equals 1 to n mu is equal to 0. And that's clearly equivalent to sum of xi, I equals from 1 to n, equals n times mu. And when you divide, you get that mu is equal sum of xi divided by n, so it's just the mean. So maximum, yes?
After you differentiate, are you missing a 2?
Yes, I am missing the 2. Very good. I am missing the 2 in front of IQ. So there is 2 missing because of the square. Thank you very much. Of course, it doesn't change anything here because it's still, this is equal to 0 in the same. Thank you very much for that. Okie dokie. So, maximum likelihood estimation is precisely the mean. And we know that the expected value of the mean is the right, this is an unbiased estimator, all right? The variance, of course, of the mean of this estimator is small. It's 1 over n times the variance of x. Let's see now. Yes.
How did you jump from that last step with all the expressions to this? No, the one up. So that the one above. How did you jump from that expression to this?
You mean from this expression?
Yeah, to the.
To that expression.
Yeah.
Well, this is equal to zero. What is it? It's a product. So the product is zero when at least one of them is zero.
Yeah.
But this can never be zero.
Yeah.
This also can never be zero.
Yeah.
Right? So the only possibility is that this sum is equal to zero.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's it, right?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Let's now see what would estimation of the variance of the measurements be. So we have to compute the other partial, which is df over d sigma. Well, you know what? Sigma is everywhere squared. So let me compute. Let me replace sigma squared by V. So V is equal to sigma squared, so to make simple the expressions simple. When I differentiate this with respect to sigma squared, right, what do I get? I get a big mess, right? It is a product, so I have to first differentiate the first one. So let's simplify the expression so that I don't make a mistake. So let's see, f of x1 up to xn is equal 2 pi to the power n over 2 times variance to the power n over 2 to the power minus n over 2, what am I saying? Right, minus n over 2, minus n over 2, and then here I have this e to the minus, and then I have sum of xi minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared, 2v. And let me differentiate this. So now df over dv is equal, this is a constant.
Just a couple of seconds. Pinch line it up. And you should all, in the project or negotiating an integrated project. Okay. So,
the web stream is going to be confused.
It's going to be.
That you're going.
Okay. So now when I differentiate this, what do I get?
And I want all of you to be involved in the pitch. So you're all going to have to stand up the front. And.
Right? That's the derivative of this guy times e to the minus sum xi minus mu squared divided by v. And then I have plus v to the minus n over 2 times the derivative of this. And the derivative of this is what? It's, e to the minus sum of all of these guys, xi minus mu squared divided by 2v times the derivative of, how does it work? Times the derivative of this, and this here, let's write it a little bit easier form, is e to the minus sum of xi minus mu squared d divided by 2 times v to the minus 1. So times the derivative of this, which is minus sum of xi minus mu squared divided by 2 times the derivative of v to the minus 1, which is minus 1 times v to the minus 2. And what do we get now? If we solve this, right, we have to set this equal to 0 and then solve the system of the equations. Okay, so what cannot be 0? This cannot be 0, so we can forget about this guy. And this is a common factor, this, and this cannot be 0. So what do we get? We get, okay, so then we have v to the n minus 2, v to the n minus 2, this can go away as well. So we have that df over dv is 0 if and only if minus n divided by 2 v to the minus 1 plus v to the minus 2, and I have minus 1 and minus 1 that becomes plus, this is gone, so I have this minus is gone, so this will be just sum of xi minus mu squared divided by 2, so I can multiply by 2, and this will be just this times this is equal to 0, so if I multiply with v squared, I get minus nv is equal, so I get nv is equal to sum of xi minus mu squared, so I get that the variance is equal sum of xi minus mu squared divided by n, but we know that mu is equal to x1 plus xn divided by 2 from the first equation, from dv, df over d mu equal to 0. So this will then imply that my estimate for the variance looks like this. How much time do we have left? Okay, very good, we will finish this. Okay, so we have that the variance is equal sum of xi minus x bar, right, because this is what mu is, squared divided by n. So this is the estimation, maximum likelihood estimation of the variance. How good is it? Is it unbiased? Have you seen this before? What did we show? We showed that actually estimating this as this is then in this case expected value of V prime is the true variance. Here, the expected value of V, this it will be n minus 1 divided by n times this sum squared divided by n minus 1, and then expected value of this, right? Which is equal to n minus 1 divided by n, and we know that the expected value of this estimator is the true variance. So we get that this is n minus 1 divided by n times true variance. So the maximum likelihood estimator is slightly biased because it proposes to estimate variance with this when we know that this will be too small because actually you should put here n minus 1. But if the sample size is large, it will converge to the true variance. So this is what maximum likelihood tells us how to estimate variance of our measuring instrument. Besides making measurements by a single instrument, in more kind of realistic setup, we actually make measurements with different instruments. And the prime example for that are wireless sensor networks. Right? You have one sensor here, you know, a bunch of sensors that monitor temperature, and they are kind of in different positions and they are influenced by different factors. So they have different variances. So what we want to now do is the following. If the measurement is done by n sensors, and you do know their variances, what will maximum likelihood estimation tell us? How should we aggregate that data? Right, so the setup will be, we have, and you know, the sensors don't have to be electronic devices. Sensors can be, say humans ranking something, right? And some humans can be, for example, you submit your homeworks and you have different tutors. So when in 3-1-2-1 I had tutors, each tutor marks only one question, right, for all students, rather than one tutor marks, say, a quarter of the assignments of all students, all the assignment, and the second. Why do you think I actually have a single tutor marking everyone's assignment? One problem.
It'll have different biases.
Exactly. Different tutors have different, maybe have different biases and different variances, right? So to ensure that the things are reasonably consistent, I give all the problem number one of all students is marked by the same tutor. And even then they screw it up, right? So the point is this, but sometimes that's not possible to do. Sometimes you know that, you know, for example, in crowdsourcing, when people are asked to evaluate something, like to evaluate products or whatever, you have to count on the fact that different estimators will have different variances. different rates or different sensors in a network. So when you have such heterogeneous data, it's of utmost importance to aggregate it in an optimal way. So the setup is now as follows. You have a bunch of sensors. As I say, they can be also humans. This is applicable to many, many things. You know, because of this digital proliferation, nowadays everything is turned into a number, and you have this massive avalanche of data. And so it's of fundamental importance to optimally aggregate your data. For example, in business, you know, if you have some market research and you have gazillions of responders, it's of fundamental importance how to summarize data in a way that you can make an optimal business decision, for example. So this is why I'm doing this for you. It's, you know, you have this craze for big data and data science and whatever. So these are really the very basic screws, how to aggregate data in an optimal way. So this will be the setup. You will have sensor S1, S2, S3, up to Sn. And they will perform a sequence of measurements, M1, at instant t1, M1, and instant t2, M1 at instant tk, say. And then this one will do measurement 2 at instant t1, measurement 2 at t2, measurement 2 at tk, and finally here, measurement N at T1, measurement M at T2, up to measurement M at TK. And you know the variance of each sensor, V2. Say, for example, because you tested them in a lab and you computed and you ran one of these estimators for the variance, for example, this one, you did gazillions of measurements and you find a good estimate for the variance of each sensor. Now the question is, how should you aggregate their data? And the most remarkable thing is, one might say that's very simple. Pick the instrument which has smallest variance and use its readings. It turns out that's a very bad choice because you can aggregate the measurements in a way that beats significantly the best instrument. So you should not throw away measurements of any of the sensors, even if some are lousy, right? So that's our task for next time. But what is the problem there? In business applications, when there are no instruments but kind of human feedback, you have no clue what the variances are. You have only measurements. How do you aggregate data optimally then? Right?
Using max likelihood.
Well, we will see if we could do it. You see, you have to satisfy a lot of, you know, to use maximum likelihood, you will see next time. If you knew the variances, then maximum likelihood, you know, you will see how you choose what maximum likelihood does. But we have to do essentially kind of simulate maximum likelihood when we don't have the variances. So that's for next time. So this is all because of the bloody big data. If you go out, most of you will end up doing data analytics in banks, in so you will need to know basic statistics. So do yourself a favor, if you haven't taken a statistic class, or at least read the notes and pick up at least the basics, and then you can build on that later. Because this all today, everything is about data, digital economy, blah, blah, blah.
I have a question.